So today I'll be discussing about the last unit of your course on electronic circuits. Now, this particular unit is on power amplifiers. So in the last previous units, we have talked about the different types of small signal amplifiers. Like we have considered voltage amplifiers, we have considered current amplifiers, we have considered transconductance and transresistance amplifier. So the obvious question which must arise in your mind is that why there is a need of separate type of amplifier which is known as a power amplifier. Now, before discussing anything regarding the power amplifier, let me just tell you, or let me show you the IV characteristics or input characteristics of any bipolar junction transistor, which will help you to understand why there is a different section called power amplifier is needed at all. Now let me draw the current voltage characteristics, that means IV versus VB characteristics of any small signal amplifier, of any bipolar junction transistor, which is an essential part of a small signal amplifier. You have seen that this IV versus VB, that particular graph is just like an exponential one. And you know the relationship. That is, if I just once again write it down for your understanding once again. So it was something like that. IB is equal to IS by beta into you have exponential VB upon VT. Sometimes there is an empirical factor eta multiplied with that. So exponential eta VB by VT minus 1. So that is the relationship between IB versus VB. And you have found that this particular nature is an exponential one. Now, while discussing small signal amplifier, single stage small signal amplifier, we have considered that the variation of the time varying component is small with respect to the thermal voltage. That means if I consider this VB by VT, that particular ratio, we have considered that this VB by VT is pretty small, much less than one, or less than one, so that this exponential x can be approximated like 1 plus x only, so that those higher order terms like x square, x cube can be neglected. In other words, if I just consider the variation of this IB with respect to VB, so eventually it's an exponential nature, but if I restrict my operation, for example, this is the DC bias, for example, let me consider this is the DC operating point marked by this red, known as VBQ, and the corresponding current, the base current, as you're getting over here, is IBQ. Now, over and above this DC operating point, some small signal is superimposed, and accordingly, the amplification takes place. Now, we have considered that with respect to this particular point, although the variation is like an exponential one, but if I restrict my region of operation to be small enough so that this exponential nature can be regarded to be a linear one. Or in other words, as far as the mathematics is concerned, this e to the power x can be regarded to be close to 1 plus x, so that the higher order terms can be neglected. So that was the scenario which we have considered in the small signal amplifier. And that's why the amplifier is known as a small signal, because the variation of the time varying component is small with respect to the thermal voltage. Now, after several stages of amplification, the output waveform is pretty large. And to some extent, this particular output waveform needs to be fed to some specific load for our application. If I consider the transmitter side of any audio amplifier section, then you'll see that in case of audio amplifier, the load which we will consider is the loudspeaker. So the signal which has been developed by means of several stages of pre-amplification, let there be two or three stages of single stage common emitter section, by virtue of that, the signal is already multiplied or amplified to a given level. Suppose there are few stages of pre-amplifier section. Suppose this is the amplifier 1, A1. There could have been another stage like A2 and A3. So there are several stages of single stage amplifier. And by virtue of that, the signal has been enhanced to a sufficiently high level. Now, the corresponding waveform, what we are getting over here, so for the sake of simplicity, I'm just considering a sinusoidal kind of thing. But you know that for an audio amplifier, the signal, the small signal can assume any arbitrary shape depending upon the nature of the generated audio. Now for audio amplifier, the last stage is essentially the power amplifier section where the developed waveform needs to be delivered to the load. And in case of audio amplifier, the load is nothing but a loudspeaker. And in order to ensure that the loudspeaker operates appropriately, the corresponding power output should be large enough. Typically, the power delivered to the load for a loudspeaker is in the order of few watts, like 1 watt or 2 watt. So accordingly, you have to generate some means so that this high power output is delivered to the load. And as far as the load is concerned, for any loudspeaker or for an audio amplifier, the load is the loudspeaker and the corresponding resistance provided by the loudspeaker, like 4 ohms or 8 ohms. So typical value of resistance is very small, in the order of 4 ohms or 8 ohms, unlike the typical load resistance which we have considered so far, RC or RL, which was in the range of few kilo ohms. So if I consider small signal single stage amplifier, which we have encountered already, we have seen that the typical value of the load resistance is very large, in the order of few kilo ohms, like 2 kilo ohms, 3 kilo ohms or so. But for this type of amplifier, the corresponding load resistance is very small, in the order of few ohms. Now you have to develop some means so that the high power, in the order of 1 watt or 2 watt power, is delivered to the load, so that the load can operate properly and it can produce the corresponding acoustic signal at the output of the loudspeaker. So once again, if I just consider the type of the load over here, for which the value is very small, like 4 ohms or 8 ohms, then we cannot typically use a single stage common emitter amplifier. Why? Because you know that for common emitter amplifier, both the input and the output resistances, they are moderately high. So in the order of few kilo ohms. However, if I consider the other types of amplifiers or other configurations of amplifier, which we have discussed so far, you'll see that for common base amplifier, the input resistance is very small and the output resistance is very large. And on the other hand, for common collector amplifier, the input resistance is very large and output resistance is very small. So that's why this common collector amplifier is also known as buffer. Because if you can remember properly, that for common collector amplifier, there is no such amplification. Whatever the input signal you are providing at the base, the same input signal is replicated at the output without any phase reversal and without any gain. So that's why it is known as a voltage buffer. And the only purpose of using a common collector amplifier is to ensure that the voltage, that the corresponding resistance value is matched properly. So for impedance matching operation, this common collector amplifier is typically used. Now here also, as you find that the common collector amplifier, the input resistance is very large. So we can expect that. So if I just draw the corresponding block diagram of a common collector amplifier, so already we have a signal developed over here. And this is the input resistance, Rin, of common collector amplifier. And this is the, let it be, after several stages of amplification, we have got some amplified version of the waveform at this particular point. And let this voltage be, let it be like some AV times Vin, where Vin is the actual input provided. And this is the output voltage, output resistance over here, R out, of the previous stage of amplifier, let it be R out. Now, since Rin value for common collector stage is typically very large, in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms, So you understand that most of the voltage AV Vin will be coupled over here. So coupling loss will be significantly small. And on the other hand, this common collector stage will provide a very small output resistance so that the impedance matching is established over here. In case of power amplifier, we don't need an additional stage of amplification because the signal has already been enhanced to the desired level. The only thing that we need to perform over here is to ensure that the signal, the small signal, the signal which has been developed by means of previous stages of amplifier, the corresponding signal has to be delivered to the load so that the corresponding power level is high enough, which will be required for the appropriate operation of the load. So in case of audio amplifier, the load is nothing but the loudspeaker. Now let us consider some BJT implementation of a common collector stage. So as you know, for common collector, if I consider simplest biasing arrangement, only one resistance is there, let it be RB. This resistance RB is there, and the collector stage is, this collector terminal is directly connected to the power supply line, VCC, and we have the loudspeaker. Loudspeaker is acting as the load, and the load is connected at the emitter end. So with simplest biasing, the circuit looks something like that. And we are applying the input signal over here. So as you know, so this is the input signal. We are applying V in for this common collector stage. And as you know, this V in and V out, they are exactly the same because there is no such phase shift and there is no such voltage gain pertaining to that. Now here, the typical value, so let it be RL, and the typical value of RL is in the order of like few ohms. So let it be 4 ohms, for example, for a loudspeaker. Now, if I assume that we have a 6 volt plus 6 volt supply over here, plus 6 volt supply. Now, let us have a look. How does the output voltage vary with respect to the variation in the collector current? Now, to ensure that the maximum symmetrical swing is possible, so let us assume that the voltage waveform at this particular end is fixed at 3 volt. That means essentially at the middle between 6 volt and ground, because this is the VCC value which I take in this particular case as 6 volt, and this is the ground line, so the corresponding absolute value is equal to 0 volt. So I am keeping this one, this DC value at V out is equal to 3 volt. So as to ensure that the maximum symmetrical swing is possible. Then this V out at max go up to 6 volt, and it can come down up to 0 volt, ideally. So this voltage at max, it could have been 6 volt, and this voltage is kept at 0 volt. However, if I assume that the transistor is a practical one, so in which case you know that even if there is a significant amount of current is flowing through the transistor so that the transistor enters into the saturation region, so then also you know that the corresponding voltage difference between the collector emitter, this VC sat, which we normally refer, so it can't be zero. So this VC sat becomes, say, close to 0.2 to 0.3 volt. So under this condition, we can't expect that the peak of the waveform over here reach at 6 volt. Rather, I can assume that the maximum value of the output waveform over here is 6 volt minus 0.3 volt, because the total voltage over here is 6 volt. Now this 6 volt is dropped across this collector emitter and across this loudspeaker. Now in case when the significant amount of current is flowing through the circuit, IC, so then the corresponding voltage developed across this collector emitter is 3 volt 0.3 volt, so the rest of the voltage will be available across the loudspeaker. So for any practical calculation, you have to consider this VC saturation voltage, which is 0.2 to 0.3 volt. However, for a quick calculation, you can always get rid of this 0.3 volt, and you can assume that under the condition when the input voltage reaches at the peak, then the output waveform is at 6 volt. And on the other hand, the minimum value of the output voltage is kept at 0 volt. So therefore, the excursion of the output waveform is from 0 volt to 6 volt. Or in other words, I can say that since it is VCC, in other words, I can say that the peak of the signal can reach up to VCC, and the maximum value equal to, VCC, and the minimum it is zero, and this value is kept at VCC by 2, so that the maximum symmetrical swing is possible. So this is true for any arbitrary VCC. For a 6 volt power supply, it is at 6 volt, 3 volt, and 0 respectively. Now, under this condition, you have to find out what is the amount of current that is flowing through the circuit. So you can easily calculate under DC condition, when the small signal is absent, the signal is absent over here, the time varying signal is absent over here, I have kept the value at 3 volt. So if it is 3 volt, so now it is the current that will flow through the circuit under the DC condition, that is ICQ, is nothing but 3 volt upon 4 ohms. So you understand the amount of current that is flowing. So 3 volt means 3000 millivolt upon 4 ohms. So it will be like 750 milliampere. So now you must try to compare this value with the typical value of IC, which you have observed so far. For a small signal amplifier, you have seen that the typical value of IC is in the order of few milliamperes, like 5 milliamperes, 8 milliamperes, so within that range. Now, for power amplifier, since the corresponding value of the load resistance is very small, in the order of few ohms only, or tens of ohms, so that's why the corresponding value of ICQ, or the collector current, is typically very large, and in the order of few hundreds of milliamperes. So you must understand that this hundreds of milliampere current will not be supplied by any normal transistor or low power transistor. So that's why the transistor which will be employed in case of power, in case of this power amplifier, or for the design of power amplifier, is not a simple low power transistor. Rather, we need a high power transistor over here, which can supply this amount of current in the order of few hundreds of milliamperes. And on the other hand, you must have some arrangement so that the power or the heat that is generated because of the flow of this high amount of current should be. So you must have some mechanism. So let me just also find it out, the corresponding value of IBQ. So then also you can compare. So this is 750 milliampere. If I just compare with, let it be, let beta equal to 150. So it is like in the order of few milliampere. So you just compare this one. So IBQ, the corresponding quiescent base current for a power transistor, is almost equivalent to the collector current for any low power transistor. For a low power transistor, which we have discussed so far, the corresponding collector current is in the order of few milliamperes, and the base current is in the order of few microamperes. Now here you find that the base current for any power amplifier is equivalent to the collector current of a small low power transistor, a small signal transistor. However, the collector current value is pretty large, in the order of few hundreds and milliamperes. So that's why you must have some heat sink arrangement so that the heat that is developed because of the flow of this amount of current, this large amount of current, so that heat must have proper arrangement so that the corresponding junctions of those transistors are safe. So now, what is happening? The corresponding value of ICQ is 750 milliampere and the IBQ is 5 milliampere. On the other hand, if I just consider the peak value of the IC, the peak value of IC is pretty large. So IC peak, as you observe from this particular expression, so IC peak is like 6 volt upon 4 ohms. So it is even larger. So for this particular case, it is like 1.5 ampere. So very large, 1500 milliampere. So you must have some heat sink arrangement so that the corresponding junctions of the transistors are not damaged at all. And whenever this amount of current is flowing through the transistor, it is expected that the junction temperature of the BJT will be enhanced beyond, say, 100 or 150 degrees centigrade. And there is a possibility that because of the increase of the junction temperature, the several properties of this bipolar junction transistor will be damaged. And to ensure that the properties are maintained, that means the junction temperature is kept at a very low value within the prescribed limit, then you must have some heat sink arrangement. So you must understand that this power amplifier, this design of the power amplifier, is not accomplished with the aid of a simple small signal amplifier, a small signal transistor, a small power transistor, a low power transistor. You require high power BJT for this particular operation, which can support this amount of current through it. Now, under this condition, you have to find out what is the amount of power which has been delivered to the load. Now, to understand the power delivered to the load, you have to observe the current waveform or the voltage waveform. So, since we have a resistive kind of load, so the voltage waveform and the current waveform will be the same. Now, to find out the power delivered to the load, you need to find out the RMS value of the voltage waveform. So, to calculate the power delivered to the load, the power delivered to the load PL is nothing but the RMS value, VL RMS, or I can also write VO RMS. So, RMS value of the output voltage, VO RMS. VO RMS square, so this RMS value divided by RL, divided by RL, the load resistance. Now, how to find out the RMS value of this particular waveform? If I just consider, we have a 3 volt supply over here. I mean, this VCC by 2 is at 3 volt. That means under DC condition, you have a 3 volt signal like this. And over and above this, you have a sinusoidal signal for which the peak is at 3 volt, plus 3 to minus 3. So, over and above this, plus 3 and minus 3. So, overall, it is 6 to 0, just like this. So, this is nothing but for a sinusoidal signal, which looks something like that, with a variation from, say, 0, then plus 3 over here and minus 3 over here. So, the corresponding RMS value is given by the peak by root 2 whole square. I mean, V naught RMS will be 3 by root 2. This is the V naught RMS, expression for V naught RMS. So, we have to calculate the V naught RMS square. It will be like 3 by root 2 whole square multiplied with 1 by 4. This is the load resistance, 4 watt, 4 ohms. So ultimately, you have 9 by 8 watt. Root 2 whole square is 2, 2 into 4, 8. So 9 by 8 watt. So almost 1 watt of power is needed, or 1 watt of power is delivered to the load by virtue of that. Now, apart from that, you need to find out what is the DC power being supplied over here. Now, in order to find out the DC power, you need to calculate the DC current that is flowing. So PDC is nothing but the supply voltage is VCC multiplied with the DC current that is flowing through the circuit. So VCC into IDC. So what is the DC current? So you understand that the DC voltage is kept at 3 volt. So under no signal condition, when the signal is absent, when the time varying signal is absent, the DC voltage, this V out, under quiescent condition, it is kept at 3 volt. So, as a matter of fact, the current that is flowing under DC condition is 3 volt upon 4 ohms. This ICQ we have already calculated. So, this is nothing but 3 volt by 4 ohms. So, accordingly, if I put that particular value, you'll see that. So, VCC is kept at 6 volt multiplied with 3 volt by 4. Ohms. So this what is the value? it will be like 9 by 2, 9 by 2 watt. So accordingly, you can calculate the efficiency of this power amplifier. So efficiency resulting from this power amplifier, efficiency eta, is given by the power delivered to the load divided by the DC power. So this is 9 by 8 watt in the numerator, and the denominator you have 9 by 2 watt. So ultimately it will be 2 by 8 or 1 by 4, that is 25%. So what does it mean? Out of 100 watt power, the 25 watt power will be delivered to the load and rest of the power will be lost within the circuit. Now, for any power amplifier, we are very much concerned about this power efficiency, because even if we have considered the different types of small signal amplifiers in the previous units, previous modules, while we have discussed about the single stage small signal amplifier or multi-stage small signal amplifier, but that time the amount of current, the collector current which is flowing through the circuit is very small, in the order of few milliamperes. Now, if some milliampere amount of current is flowing through the circuit, and even if there is a VCC value of say 6 volt or 8 volt or 10 volt, since the amount of current that is flowing is very small, in the order of few milliamperes, so the power being lost in the form of heat within the BJT circuit is pretty small. So it is not in the range of few watts. So it is in the range of few milliwatts. So that's why you can safely neglect that part. So the question of power efficiency did not arise in case of small signal amplifier, because the current that is flowing through the circuit is essentially very small. However, the same situation is not at all true for any power amplifier, because for the power amplifier, which involves power transistor for its design, so this power transistor provides a very high value of current in the order of few hundreds of milliamperes. So that's why we cannot get rid of the efficiency. So we must be very much accurate in calculating the efficiency of the circuit. Now, this particular calculation has been done for a particular value of VCC and for a particular value of RL. Now, let me just consider some generic circuit and some generic calculation. Once again, let me draw the circuit very quickly. So now let me just show this load by means of simple resistance. The typical value is in the order of 4 ohms or so. So this is the supply. They provided RB over here. This is RL. Now the signal is being applied over here at the base terminal. And we're taking the output from this terminal, V0. And you know that this is kept at VCC by 2. And over and above this, we have a signal like this. Now this fluctuation, if I assume that this fluctuation, let it be Vm. This is Vm. If I assume that this fluctuation is Vm, so that means if I just extract the time varying component, so time varying component will look something like that, with a peak amplitude equal to Vm, which is riding on a DC value of VCC by 2. So this is Vm. So just by observing this type of waveform, we can readily identify the power delivered to the load. What is the power delivered to the load? So this is nothing but we have to extract the corresponding small signal waveform, which looks something like that. So I can always write this waveform like Vm sine of omega t for angular frequency of omega. So you can readily calculate the corresponding RMS value. So RMS value is given by Vm upon root 2. So this RMS square divided by RL. So I'm just considering the general value of efficiency. So this is nothing but Vm square by 2RL. So this is the expression for the power delivered to the load for any arbitrary Vm and arbitrary RL. What is the DC power being lost over here, or what is the value? So you have to calculate this by VCC multiplied with IDC. So VCC, I am keeping like VCC. What is IDC? So IDC is nothing but VCC by 2RL, because under DC condition, this V0 value equal to VCC by 2. So what is the amount of IC? So IDCQ or IDC, I can write like VCC by 2 divided by RL. That means VCC by 2 RL. So if I put this value over here, so it will be like VCC square by 2 RL. So if I calculate the efficiency, which is the ratio between PL and PTC, so this is coming like VM by VCC whole square. So this is the efficiency, expression for efficiency. Now to find out the maximum efficiency is obtained when VM is at its maximum value. VM is at its maximum value, VM max. Now what could have been the maximum value of VM? So this is the sinusoidal signal which has been superimposed on VCC by 2. So since the power supply is kept at VCC, so in order to have the faithful reproduction of the output waveform, you must ensure that the VM max would have been VCC by 2 only, so that VM max should be at VCC by 2. Otherwise, there will be clipping. So VCC by 2. So from which we can deduce that the maximum efficiency is 25% or 1 by 4. So out of 100 watt of power, only 25 watt of power will be delivered to the load. And moreover, if I just once again observe the expression, you will see that if the VM value is not equal to VM max, but suppose half of the VM max, so VM max equal to VCC by 2, suppose for any particular application, VM value is equal to half of the VM max. So in which case, you will find that the efficiency will be 1 by 4 times of the eta max. So for a change of VM max by a factor of x, then the value of, or for a change of VM by a factor of x, the value of eta will be changed by a factor of x squared. There is a quadratic expression. So these are the two essential disadvantages associated with this type of circuit, this type of power amplifier circuit. However, you'll find that this output waveform is available for the entire duration of the input waveform. So the conduction angle for this type of amplifier is equal to 360 degree. And here, in this particular case, even if the signal is absent, that means even if the time varying signal is absent, even if it is absent, there is a continuous amount of, some non-zero amount of DC current will be flowing, and for which there is a significant amount of power loss takes place. And this VBEQ under no signal condition, this is close to like 0.6 to 0.7 volt. So to enhance the power efficiency of this type of power amplifier circuit, now before going into that, let me tell you that this type of amplifier circuit, power amplifier circuit, is known as class A power amplifier, which acts class A power amplifier, class A power amplifier, which operates for the entire duration of the input waveform from 0 to 360 degree. However, the power efficiency is not that high. It's only 25% only. And it requires a non-zero DC bias between its base and emitter terminal. So you understand that this potential VBE, it is already close to like 0.6 to 0.7 volt. But because of this non-zero DC current which is flowing through the circuit, there is a significant amount of loss which is taking place. So that's why people have thought to design some circuit, some power amplifier circuit in common collector configuration without providing any bias to the base circuit. Now let us have a look how does this particular circuit look like. So as I've already mentioned, for this circuit, for the second circuit which we are going to consider right now, this base terminal is not at all biased. So if this is the collector terminal, the collector is directly connected to the VCC supply line. So this is VCC. Base is hanging. Base is not at all biased. Base is not at all biased. So there is a resistance. This is the load resistance, RL. For audio amplifier, this is the loudspeaker. You are applying input directly over here through a coupling capacitor preferably, and this is the output terminal. So far, if I just compare this with the previous circuit, you'll see that, let me draw the IBPV characteristics once again. So previously we have made this VBQ at this particular point over here. This is a VBQ value. That means there is a bias. Even if the input signal is absent, there is a bias. But this time, this base is hanging. There is no bias under no signal condition. So that means we are over here at this particular point. We are over here. So now, suppose you are applying some input signal, sinusoidal signal, for example, I'm considering, just like this. Now what happens during the positive half cycle, if I just neglect any non-ideality, or if I assume that if VB is greater than zero, then the transistor will be operating. So under this condition, during the positive half cycle, obviously you can expect that the collector current will be developed, base current will be developed, and this will generate the approximate collector current. However, during the negative half cycle, the transistor is cut off. So transistor will not generate any output waveform during the negative half cycle. So under this condition, if I just neglect the cut-in voltage of the transistor, if I assume that the cut-in voltage is equal to 0 volt only, so for an input like this over here, for a sinusoidal input like this over here at the input terminal, you can expect the output is nothing but, or it will look something like that. Half-wave rectifier version. During the positive half cycle, the transistor will be on and it will develop some output waveform. And since this is a kind of a common collector configuration, or which acts like a voltage buffer or emitter follower, so the input will be replicated at the output side. However, during the negative half cycle, it will not be replicated, because during that time the transistor moves into the cutoff region, so it cannot conduct. So the output waveform will look something like that. Now you must argue that what is the need of having an output waveform which is an half-wave rectifier version of an input voltage. Anyway, so we will answer this question later on. But before that, let me if I have to accept this type of waveform, let me try to find out what is the amount of power which is delivered to the load, and what about efficiency of the circuit under this condition. Although it is acceptable, it is not at all acceptable that this type of waveform is applicable for our applications. Now under this condition, whenever you have a waveform like this, so this is the waveform. So under this condition, we expect that under the DC condition, there is no voltage over here, and whenever the input signal is at its peak, then the output will look something like that. So therefore, here the signal excursion will be from 0 to VCC. So if I assume that VCC is equal to 6 volt, then it will be like 0 to 6 volt. Under DC condition, the voltage across the load resistance will be 0. And whenever the input signal goes like this, then the output waveform will be something like that. So the peak will be at VCC, or 6 volt in our case. So if we want to find out the power delivered to the load, the same expression I have to follow. That means VORMS square, the root mean square value, and square of that upon RL. Now for a waveform like this, a half-wave rectifier version, for which the peak is at VCC. So then the RMS value is nothing but VCC by 2 from your knowledge in the unit 2. Or perhaps in unit 1, in which case we have discussed about the rectifier circuit. So it will be nothing but VCC by 2 instead of root 2. So VCC by 2 whole square, this is nothing but the VORMS square into 1 by RL. So I can have like VCC square by 4 RL. So this is the expression for power delivered to the load. On the other hand, if I want to find out the power, the DC power being supplied, so DC power being supplied is nothing but VCC multiplied with the IDC. Now, what about IDC? Now, for this type of waveform, I have to find out the IDC value. And what is IDC? So IDC is nothing but VDC upon RL. Now, what is the VDC value? What about the DC value for this half-wave rectifier? This is nothing but the peak divided by pi. So once again, refer back to your knowledge in the rectifier circuit. So this is nothing but you have VCC over here divided by pi RL. So ultimately, this is nothing but VCC whole square by pi RL. So this is the power, DC power being supplied. So once again, if you want to find out the efficiency, in fact, this is the maximum efficiency which we are considering over here. So this efficiency is given by PL upon PDC. So PL is VCC square by 4 RL, PDC is equal to VCC square by pi RL. So ultimately, is reduced to pi by 4. And if you put the value of pi over here, this is close to 78.5%. So one thing you must appreciate that the eta max value obviously is the maximum value of the efficiency. The maximum value of the efficiency has been enhanced significantly with respect to 25%. Now the maximum value has been enhanced to 78.5%. However, we are not at all satisfied with the type of the waveform because it is a half-wave rectified waveform. So it is not at all acceptable, but the power efficiency is significantly improved. On the other hand, if I want to calculate the eta value without considering the maximum value of eta, so you understand that if I want to represent this output waveform as a function of Vm only, so it is something like that. Suppose the peak is at Vm. If it is at Vm, so under this condition, I can write the power delivered to the load. I can write this like, instead of writing like VCC by 2, if the peak is at Vm, so I can write in like Vm by 2 whole square into 1 by RL, that is equal to Vm square by 4 RL for any arbitrary Vm. And what about the PDC under this condition? So PDC will be VCC into IDC. So what is the IDC value then? So IDC will be Vm upon pi RL. So VCC into Vm upon pi RL. Now from that, if I want to calculate the efficiency for an arbitrary Vm, you'll find that it will be nothing but Vm upon VCC into pi by 4. So to obtain the eta max, this Vm by VCC has to be maximum. Now what is the value of maximum value of Vm? So as you understand, the peak value of Vm is given by VCC. So under this condition, eta max will be given by 78.5%. So there is two differences. If I just compare the expression for eta for this type of amplifier as compared to the previous class A amplifier. So here you find that the maximum value of eta has been enhanced significantly, almost three times enhancement with respect to 25%. Now, in this particular case, we find that the eta max is like 78.5%. So this is the first advantage associated with this circuit. And the second advantage, what we get over here is that this ratio Vm by VCC, the corresponding power is one only. Previously, it was changing quadratically. There was Vm by VCC whole square only, but this time we have Vm by VCC only, so that if Vm changes by a factor of x, then the corresponding value of eta will also change by the same factor x. But in the last case, if for this class A power amplifier, if Vm changes by a factor of say x, then the corresponding eta value will change by a factor of x square. So this is the second advantage what we get out of this type of amplifier. However, there is a significant lag which we must point out, or rather we have already pointed out this one, that the output waveform is not at all satisfactory. Output waveform is a half-wave rectified version. So therefore, we need to somehow extract the negative half as well. Now, this could have been done using a different types of amplifier, or rather using different types of transistor. Now, here we have considered NPN type of transistor so as to ensure that the positive half cycles are replicated at the output side. Now, if I use a negative, or if you want to have the negative sides over here, so in this particular case, I have to use a PNP type of transistor, which can reproduce the negative half of the input waveform. Now, for this one, let me draw the circuit. So This time we have a PNP type of transistor. PNP type of transistor, so the collector should be at minus VCC. The base is not at all biased. And we have the emitter terminal over here, and there's a load resistance RL, and this point is grounded. So this is the output waveform. I mean, the output voltage is obtained from this particular terminal. Now, you find that this particular terminal is at zero. So in case when the input signal goes negative, so we have a PNP kind of thing over here, PNP. Collector is a P-type, base is of N-type, and emitter is a P-type. So in case the input signal goes negative, then the base potential is at more negative with respect to the emitter potential. So then only this particular bipolar junction transistor will be operating, and the output waveform will be obtained. So the output waveform obtained only during the negative half cycle. So here we will find a waveform like this. During the negative half cycle only, the output waveform will be developed, because during that time the transistor will be active. On the other hand, when the input signal is positively going, during the positive half cycle, this PN junction, this base emitter junction, is reverse biased, and as a matter of fact, this particular bipolar junction transistor will not be active. So we have a waveform like this, and following the same analysis, we can also find out that this eta max for this particular case is also given by the same expression, that is 78.5%. Now, each of these two different stages, that means this amplifier involving this PNP transistor regenerates the negative half cycle, and the previous amplifier involving the NPN transistor regenerates the positive half cycle. Each of them provides a maximum efficiency of 78.5%, and for each of them, the conduction angle, ideally, it is 180 degree. Now, in order to obtain the full waveform, that means the positive half cycle and negative half cycle together, we need to connect these two different amplifiers together, so that at the output end, we can have the full sinusoidal waveform. Now, for this, I can draw this one, which we have discussed previously, using the NPN transistor. It was something like that. So this particular point is kept at plus VCC. And we have RL over here. So this is the V0 terminal, some kind of NPN transistor. Now we have to combine these two together, so for which the output waveform looks something like that. Now we have to combine these two together so that across the load, the full sinusoidal signal is obtained. Now for this, let me draw from the beginning. I mean, we need to start from this transistor first, and let us just flip this one. Let us just flip the diagram. So over here, this collector terminal is connected to plus VCC, and we have an NPN transistor over here, so this is plus VCC. So here you find that this RL is connected to the emitter terminal. Here also RL is connected to the emitter terminal. So what we can do is, we can tie up the two different emitters together. So two different emitters are connected together. And this is the collector of the PNP transistor, which is returned to minus VCC. So this is returned to minus VCC. This is at plus VCC. These two bases can be connected together. And we are applying the input at this particular terminal. And we have the load resistance connected at this particular point. So this is RL value. So this is Vin. Under this condition, we have NPN type of transistor at the top. At the top, we have NPN transistor for which the collector is connected to plus VCC. And base is connected to the input terminal, and at the emitter terminal we have the load resistance. Now here also for the PNP transistor is the PNP transistor for which the collector is connected to minus VCC, and at the emitter terminal we have the load resistance. Now these two together, now for an input like this, if I consider input like this, during the positive half cycle this NPN transistor will be acting and the waveform will be generated across the load resistance. We are taking the output across the load resistance RL, and during the negative half cycle this PNP transistor will be acting and it will reproduce the negative half cycle. So accordingly we have waveform like this at the output side. Since both of the two amplifiers or both of the two transistors, they are acting for 180 degree each, and each of them are having an efficiency in isolation as 78.5%. So the overall efficiency of the circuit is also 78.5%, because the operation of each of the amplifiers, I mean the upper one and the lower one, is for 180 degree, and each of them is having an efficiency of 78.5%. So the overall efficiency or the maximum efficiency obtained from this circuit is known as obtained as 78.5%. Now this type of amplifier involving NPN and PNP transistor, which involves two different power supply, plus VCC and minus VCC, is known as class B complementary power amplifier, because it involves complementary transistor, it involves NPN as well as PNP. Class B complementary amplifier or power amplifier, for which each of the transistor operates for a duration of 180 degree, and for each of the amplifier, for each of the transistor, the corresponding efficiency is given by a maximum efficiency is given by 78.5%. However, there is certain problem associated with this type of power amplifier if I just observe the property of the transistor in much more detail. Now, once again, let me allow to draw this IBVB graph once again. I'm drawing it for n number of times, the same diagram, IB versus VB. So it looks something like that, the exponential nature. So as you can understand, for class A amplifier, we have fixed the DC operating point over here. This is for class A, for which the transistor is active for the entire duration of 360 degree. However, for class B, the DC operating point is fixed over here. So for class A, it is fixed over here, and for class B, it is fixed over here. So far we have assumed that the transistor is ideal. So what does it mean? That even if the input signal for an NPN transistor, if I just once again draw very quickly this diagram, plus VCC. So we have assumed that whenever the input signal is just above zero, so it makes this base emitter junction forward biased, and the output signal will be obtained over here. But remember, for any transistor, there is an important term associated with any PN junction, which is known as cut-in voltage. So far we have assumed that the cut-in voltage is equal to 0 volt. So that means whenever the input voltage is greater than zero, the output will be developed. But remember, for any transistor, here the cut-in voltage, I cannot have a value of equal to 0 volt. Rather, the cut-in voltage value is close to like 0.4 to 0.5 volt. So the input signal must be well above the 0.4 to 0.5 volt for an NPN transistor, so that the corresponding circuit becomes operative. Similarly, for the PNP transistor, the input signal must go below minus 0.5 volt. Otherwise, the input signal will not be able to generate the corresponding output. So in other words, if I just want to draw the small signal, I mean the time varying signal over here, So far we have assumed that the input signal, I mean, the cut-in voltage is not at all playing an important role over here. But remember that cut-in voltage has something to say regarding the conduction angle. Cut-in voltage has something to say regarding the conduction angle. Although we have talked about the conduction angle of 180 degree each, but considering a non-zero cut-in voltage, the conduction angle cannot be total 180 degree. Rather, it will be somewhat less as compared to 180 degree, both for NPN as well as for PNP transistor. So I am just showing you the V gamma, this cut-in voltage, by means of dotted line. This upper one is for NPN. So this is V gamma, and the lower one is for PNP. So for PNP transistor, this cut-in voltage must be negative, and for NPN transistor, the cut-in voltage must be positive. So this is minus V gamma for PNP. So whenever the input voltage is less than V gamma but greater than minus V gamma, then none of the transistors will be operating. To ensure that the NPN transistor operates, so the input voltage must be greater than V gamma, and whenever the input voltage is less than minus V gamma, then the PNP transistor will be operating. But in case the input voltage V in lies within that range, that if the input voltage lies within that range, that minus V gamma, less than V in, less than plus V gamma, then none of the transistor will be conducting. So I'm just marking this range. So I'm just making the projection over here. If the input voltage is higher than V gamma, then only the upper transistor, NPN transistor, will be acting. And if it is less than minus V gamma, then the lower transistor, PNP transistor, will be acting. Now let me show you. Now what happens during this range? There is no problem because it is greater than plus V gamma. So obviously it will be conducted by the positive NPN transistor, the positive half cycle. There is no problem with this range. Once again, within this range, there is no problem, this to this. However, during this range, there will be no current, ideally. It is something like that. Although I have not drawn in proper scale. Anyway, it will look something like that. It will be something like that. So, from this point to that point, whenever the input voltage lies within this range, then minus V gamma, less than V in, less than V gamma, there will be almost no current. Here also, there will be almost no current. Here also, there will be almost no current. In fact, the current is here, but the corresponding slope is very small. Or in other words, I can say that this is not exactly zero, but it cannot exactly replicate the output, I mean, the input waveform. So in fact, if I just once again draw this entire waveform in isolation, so it looks something like that. It will be something like that. So at the crossover point, there is some distortion which is taking place because of the presence of non-zero V gamma. It will be something like that, the crossover points. So over here, the output waveform will be distorted. Over here, the output waveform will be distorted. And this kind of distortion is known as crossover distortion, which takes place over here, over this range. These are known as crossover distortion. Crossover distortion. Now, we need to find out some method so that this crossover distortion can be eliminated for any power amplifier. So what, first of all, to eliminate this crossover distortion, you have to identify what is the reason behind this crossover distortion. Once again, if I just consider this particular IV heavy characteristics, you know that for class A amplifier, this is the transistor is biased at this particular value, 0.6 to 0.7 volt VBQ. And for class B amplifier, these transistors are not at all biased. So therefore, this is DC operating point is kept over here. So as a trade-off, what is done for the new stage of amplifier, new type of amplifier, where this crossover distortion is eliminated. So in that particular case, this VBQ is placed at cut-in voltage. It is placed at cut-in voltage. So if it is V gamma, so both the base emitter junctions of the PNP and the NPN transistor is biased with a small value of V gamma. That means the NPN transistor is biased at plus V gamma and the PNP transistor is biased at minus V gamma. So as a matter of fact, since both of the transistors are biased at plus minus V gamma at their respective cut-in voltage, so you understand that this crossover distortion will be eliminated. And for the entire duration of the positive half cycle, the NPN transistor will be acting. And for the entire duration of the negative half cycle, the PNP transistor will be acting. And since it's a kind of trade-off between class A and class B, so this is known as a class AB type of power amplifier, class AB push-pull power amplifier, which is nothing but a compromise in between the class A and class B. Compromise in what sense? And so as far as the efficiency is concerned, you'll see that since there is a non-zero DC current that is flowing through class AB, so because of which the corresponding power loss in the circuit will be relatively high with respect to that of class B amplifier. However, it will be not that large as compared to class A amplifier. So the efficiency here, it will be somewhat in between this 25% and 78.5%, but it is very much close to 78.5%. And at the same time, both of these two transistors, they will be operating for 180 degree each, and the output waveform will be the undistorted version of the input waveform. So this is the thing which you want to achieve by using a small bias in the circuit. This can be achieved by adding some biasing resistance. So once again, let me draw the class AB circuit involving two transistors, NPN and PNP. So this is plus VCC. This is at minus VCC. We have the load resistance connected over here, RL. And this is the output terminal as well. Now, so far, these two bases were hanging. That means there is no connection. So now, to provide a small bias, so what is done? A voltage divider kind of stuff can be inserted over here, which will allow a very, if I just connect over here, let me connect first. Right. So let there be three resistances, R1, or if I want to have a symmetric kind of thing, say let it be R1 and R1, and this one is R2. And suppose the input is applied at this particular terminal through a capacitor. Now what happens is, between base to emitter, for the first transistor, for the first NPN transistor, between base to emitter, we must have a positive plus V gamma over here. Plus V gamma is needed. So it's an NPN transistor, so this should be positive, this should be negative. And this one is a PNP transistor. So once again, we require additional V gamma between these two points. Plus minus another V gamma. So between these two terminals, if I consider this terminal to be A and this terminal to be B, so between A to B, a voltage drop of 2 V gamma is ensured, or has to be ensured. So if I assume that it is like 0.5 volt each of V gamma, then we must ensure that this drop must be close to say 1 volt or so. Now under the condition when the VCC is equal to say, let it be say 6 volt, and minus VCC say minus 6 volt, so then you can ensure that out of the total 12 volts, so between this point to this point, the total drop is 12 volt. Out of that, the 1 volt is dropped across R2 and rest 11 volt is dropped across R1 and these two resistances, this R1 and this R1. So obviously, since the amount of voltage between this point A and point B is relatively small, so you must understand that the resistance value R1 is typically large with respect to R2, because across R2 the voltage drop is very small. So we need to provide this bias, this 2 phi gamma bias, so that the bases of these two transistors are getting their corresponding bias. So for which case, the output waveform which we obtain at this particular terminal, the output waveform which will be obtained across this load resistance will be something like that, without any distortion. A full waveform, full sinusoidal waveform, for example. But however, because of some non-zero amount of base current that is flowing through the circuit, we can expect that there is some kind of loss taking place in the circuit in the form of the heat, and which will eventually affect the efficiency of this power amplifier circuit. Now, apart from this particular problem, there could have been another problem associated with this circuit. In fact, what we find is, so let me once again draw the same IBPV graph. We know that this PN junction of any, I mean, if I just draw this VVIV graph, you understand that this variation is very much temperature sensitive, it's temperature dependent. So suppose, let me draw the diagram for three different temperature. So we are analyzing the same thing at three different temperature. So suppose this is for, say, this is temperature T1, this is temperature T2, this is temperature T3. You must understand that T3 is greater than T2 and T2 is greater than T1. So as temperature increases, you'll find that even for a fixed value of VBE, the corresponding, if the temperature increases, even for a fixed value of VBE, the corresponding IV value is more. So if I consider three different temperatures, T1, T2, and T3, you will see that the corresponding value of the cut-in voltage is also going to be changed. So if I just want to zoom this portion from where these graphs take off, you'll see that it looks something like that. In one case, it will be like this. In other case, it will be like this. In another case, it will be like, say, this. So suppose this is a VBE. So you'll find that in winter days, when the temperature is small, then the value of VBE, or rather this V gamma, this cut-in voltage, is relatively large. On the other hand, in summer days, where the temperature is very large, so in that case, the corresponding value of VBE is small. So therefore, the V gamma, the cut-in voltage which we are talking about, this is not at all constant throughout the year. So for a change in the ambient temperature, the corresponding value of V gamma is also going to change. So in this case, if I just want to eliminate the effect of, or if I want to incorporate this twice V gamma between the two bases of this particular class AB complementary amplifier, push-pull amplifier, then you'll see that this particular resistance cannot track the corresponding change in the V gamma value, because we can assume that the resistance value, the corresponding temperature, the corresponding coefficient, temperature coefficient, is not at all that large for a resistance R2. So what can be done to get rid of this particular problem is that instead of connecting a resistance over here, what we can do is we can always connect a set of two diodes for which we can connect, I don't know whether it is possible to draw within this particular slide or not. So I think it will be better if I go to the next slide. Let me go to the next slide and let me draw the circuit. So instead of connecting the resistance R2, because R1 is the top resistance. So instead of connecting the resistance R2 between the two bases of the two transistors. It will be better if one connects two diodes in series, which can keep track of the corresponding change in the temperature. It is something like that. I'm just drawing the complete circuit. So this is minus VCC. This is plus VCC. So we have R1 over here. This is also R1. We have a symmetrical kind of, if I assume that these two transistors are almost symmetrical in nature, and the input is applied over here, the input can reach to the second base through this. So what happens? This particular diode, so we have two diodes like D1 and D2. These two diodes are there, and these two diodes will keep track of the change in V gamma because of the change in the temperature. So accordingly, the corresponding base potential, I mean this B1 and B2, the corresponding difference between these two base potential will be kept constant at twice V gamma, irrespective of the change in the temperature. So the diodes will automatically keep track of that. This is the load resistance RL. And this type of arrangement is known as the thermal compensation for class AB push-pull power amplifier. So you must understand that for this type of amplifier, the corresponding efficiency will be somewhat less than 78.5%, because under DC condition, there is a constant current flow, which was not the case for class B power amplifier, for which case the corresponding bases are kept hanging. That means if I just consider this one, this particular circuit, there was no bias under no signal condition, there was no bias. So there was no DC current. So the corresponding efficiency, power efficiency was large, as high as 78.5%. However, there is a problem associated with this class B complementary power amplifier. The problem lies in the fact that because of non-zero V gamma, the corresponding waveforms are not properly obtained near the crossover points, and which gives rise to crossover distortion. And to get rid of this crossover distortion, this small biasing is incorporated into the circuit, and the circuit is known as a class B push-pull power amplifier. And this circuit provides distortion-free, crossover distortion-free waveform at the output, but at the cost of slight degradation in the value of power efficiency. Now, with this, I would like to conclude the discussion on power amplifier.